There are few images that evoke so universal a response. The wild horse is an archetype that dates back thousands of years and spans most civilizations. A spirit of independence, of intelligence, and of freedom uncompromised. This is the story of one group of wild horses that pounded their way across the plains of Alberta for generations, weathering the winters and slipping past the conventions of captivity. This is the story of a herd of survivors whose freedom was finally challenged by a most unlikely opponent, a fragile tract of land in southeastern Alberta.
But when I arrived there in 1987 in the middle of the controversy over the wild horses, I was shocked at what had happened in about 10 years. The ground cover was starting to get very bare. The springs had turned from lush green areas into mud holes. And a lot of the wildlife and rare plants looked to be in serious trouble.
Twelve thousand years ago, the last of the glaciers retreated from what we now call Western Canada. They left behind a landmass that would evolve over thousands of years into distinct ecological regions, each with its own native population of animals and plant life. The mixed grass prairie is one such region. An ecosystem defined by its particular blend of prairie grasses, animal, and bird life. Unique to this corner of the planet, the mixed grass prairie in Canada once stretched from southwestern Manitoba to southern Alberta. Today, in Alberta, it has been reduced to three small areas of land, each quietly trying to maintain its age-old balance while the world moves onward. The Canadian Wildlife Service has been studying this area for decades. Biologist Len Shandrick.
Well, the mixed grass prairie in Western Canada is probably one of the most impacted native ecosystems. Probably only 20% of this ecosystem remains, and 95% has been impacted by agriculture and industry.
One of the largest tracts of mixed grass prairie still left on the continent sits in an area known as the Suffield Block, a generous chunk of land 290 kilometers southeast of Calgary. On this unique plot, it wasn't agriculture or industry that altered the landscape, but the basic needs of a group of wild horses who adopted the land as their own. And their growing presence was threatening this environmentally sensitive area. For the past 50 years, the land has been reserved exclusively for the specialized needs of its unlikely landlord. This military base was established in 1941 as a training facility for British and Canadian troops. Today, it remains one of the world's largest military training sites, covering almost 2,700 square kilometers. The base sits on the Palliser Triangle, an area of land named for the 19th century British explorer who deemed it unfit for agriculture. Despite Palliser's warnings, a massive influx of immigrants flooded the empty Canadian West and settled the area. In the 1930s, the area was the center of a dust bowl that plagued the prairies for nearly a decade. By 1941, only one quarter of the original homesteaders remained. Since then, the land has been managed by the military, which trains more than 12,000 soldiers here every year. Major Dan Davies is the operations officer at Canadian Forces Base Suffield. Military maneuvers are just part of the picture.
We also have a philosophy here of multiple land use. We accommodate oil exploration. We also have archaeological sites on the base, which are set aside and protected, as well as areas where paleontologists study dinosaur bones.
But this is a military installation, and training operations are still the priority here. More than 300,000 tons of ammunition are fired off every year in rotating stations spread across the Suffield block. Beyond the noise and chaos of target practice sits the largest undisturbed prairie ecosystem remaining in North America. A refuge that covers 15% of the base's land surface. This delicate area is protected from military use.
The National Wildlife Area was established in 1992. It was set aside essentially as a sanctuary for wildlife.
By forbidding public access to the land, the military preserved and now manages a rare piece of mixed prairie grassland.
Well, the Suffield block itself is one of the largest tracts of native prairie left in North America, and it has a variety of rare and endangered species.
Cliff Wallace is the president of the Alberta Wilderness Association. His research into the rare plant and wildlife of the grasslands dates back to the 1970s.
You have everything from things like burrowing owls, which are ground nesting owls, and ferruginous hawks, which are quite large hawks that feed on rodents in the area, to smaller things like northern leopard frogs, which thrive in the small, isolated springs areas. You also have a whole host of rare plant species, a lot of which are just being documented now.
Of the 173 species of wildlife recorded in the Suffield area, 31 are rare, endangered, or threatened, making the preservation of this ecological island all the more critical. Added to the mix was a herd of wild horses that had been free to wander these plains for generations. Although the horses had adapted to the land quite comfortably, they were taking their toll on the delicate grassland. Popularly known as wild horses, the herds on Suffield were correctly termed feral. This simply means that their ancestors broke the bonds of domestication and returned to the wild. Truly wild horses exist nowhere in North America, despite the fact that it was here that they evolved. For the first 50 million years of their existence, dozens of different species of horses made their home on the plains of America. Then, 8,000 years ago, for reasons no one has understood, the last of them vanished from the continent. Although the horse became extinct in North and South America, it survived in Asia, Europe, and Africa. In the 1500s, when the Spanish conquistadors invaded the Americas, they did so on horseback, returning the horse to its ancestral homeland. In the meantime, entire ecosystems had evolved here, unfurling complex dynamics which no longer included the long absent horse. Having established their ability to survive and reproduce, the Suffield horses quickly relearned or remembered the instinctive behavior of their ancestors, reclaiming the social rituals they had lost in captivity.
They have more than their domestic horses. They have all that wild instinct. That's what they survived with in that. And when you're breaking them, training them, you try to leave that in them.
Doug Johnson is a horse trainer from central Alberta who acquired several wild horses from the Suffield block.
It's like this horse looked after himself for 6 years now. And if you took that away from him, he wouldn't look after you when you're riding him, and that you'd have to be looking after him all the time. If you leave it in him, he'll look after himself and he'll look after you when you're working.
When domestic horses return to the wild, they quickly form harems, the basic social unit. The harem consists of a mature stallion and a number of mares with which he breeds. The first mare he selects is generally the dominant or lead mare and ranks just below him in a rigid pecking order, followed by second string mares and offspring.
With these wild horses, they've had their order in the herd they've run in. They fought for whatever position they are. You've got a lead mare, and then everybody follows in behind. And these horses, they always want to be dominant. And you don't get rough with them, but you have to show them that you're not really more superior, but you're number one, that you're not scared and you're not going to hurt them at the same time. And once you accomplish this and you get this with a wild horse, they're actually no different much than working with a domestic horse.
Domestic horses are an integral part of prairie history. To the struggling homesteader, horses were magnificent and powerful workers. They hauled timber, plowed fields, and made cattle ranching possible. In just a few short decades, millions of acres of land were cultivated and harvested by horse-drawn machines. Horsepower is still used to describe the amount of work a machine can do. By the turn of the century, work with the horse had evolved into competition. To men who spent their lives riding half-wild horses and chasing cows, contests of skill were a natural source of recreation and helped make the cowboy a folk hero. Alberta's first official rodeo in 1903 launched a tradition that is closely linked to Western Canadian heritage. The Suffield herd was derived from abandoned local stock animals that were released or had escaped from the hands of farmers. Local ranchers have their own stories of the ancestry of the Suffield horses.
We had a bunch of rodeo horses that we used to use at the rodeos during the summer, and they wintered back in the hills here.
Yeah, we gathered them every spring and branded the colts and cut the studs and whatever we had to do. Kept what we wanted and turned the rest back out.
Whatever their origin, these horses had escaped drudgery to live and thrive in the wild. And in many ways, they were victims of their own success. With a population increase of 15 to 20% a year, a herd like this can double every 5 years. An their habitat was shrinking just as dramatically. Eventually, it was reduced to a fenced corner of Alberta, a highly monitored strip within a heavily armed block.
There's too many horses, and that's why the land is going the way it is. Like this old mare, she was, you know, only weighed 900 pounds when I got her last winter off this range, where normally she's 1,300, 1,400 pound horse if she had the proper grazing and that.
Normally these rose bushes are thick, brushy, and 2.5 to 4.5 feet tall. But as you can see, the tips have been bitten off by something or other of these rose bushes. The rose bush is totally unpalatable, as you can see by the thorns on the rose bush. So whatever ate this bush had to be fairly hungry, or he wouldn't be eating rose bushes.
An adult horse consumes as much as 30 pounds of food a day. A walk over horse grazing territory with Tom Livingston, a local rancher, becomes a lesson in range depletion.
This is a silver willow. And this is a brushy plant that grows on the prairie that would normally, in an area like this, you'd expect to find this plant about 6 foot high. It's a hardy perennial. But this plant has been eaten back by some large grazer because the ends are bitten off of the brush growth. Horses primarily are grass eater, but they eat most anything that grows if they get hungry enough. So the evidence of the grazing on the silver willow tells you there was no grass here to eat, or they wouldn't be eating silver willow.
Nancy Boutillier trains and shows horses. She also assesses range conditions on public lands, including the Suffield block.
Well, the horses are a very effective grazer. Unlike cows, they have two sets of teeth. They're able to come in and grasp the plant right at the base and remove all of the forage plus most of the litter, the old grass that's here.
Once this grass is ate down, it takes 3-4 years for it to come back. And if there's a fence up, the horses can't move, along with the roads and everything. So they had them closed in, and they got too many horses for the amount of land that they got on. They keep increasing the acreages, then they could have that amount of horses.
In most grazing areas, the cattle are being, and the horses are being managed. This would mean that they're put into a pasture, then they're removed when 50% of the forage has been taken off. In this particular incident, these horses weren't being managed. They were able to stay in and basically deplete all of the forage.
In their struggle to survive, the horses were wearing down a habitat that was too precious to lose.
Okay, you can see the effect of the horses on the spring areas that they're having here. You can see the terracing, the trailing. You can see how they come down into the water. They urinate, defecate in the water, which means that the wildlife essentially will try to avoid these water sources as much as they possibly can. We have 17 of these springs on the base that we're aware of. All but one of them is being impacted this way very dramatically by the horses.
We were getting a barnyard effect around the wetlands and the springs. There was lots of sign of accumulation of horse dung and excessive trampling.
The underbrush is being removed, the area is being grazed out, very few insects, therefore you don't have the same number of bird species, amphibians, reptiles, small mammals. This whole area essentially, which is necessary for the health of the indigenous species on the base, is being impacted by the horses.
The horses preferred to roam in the northeast section of the base, near the freshwater springs. The Middle Sand Hills are a particularly sensitive region of the National Wildlife Area. Located in the northern portion of the reserve, they are characterized by active, stable, and partially stable sand dunes. The grasslands of this region act as breeding grounds for shorebirds like the avocet, curlew, godwit, and plover. The sharp-tailed grouse spends all year in this area, feasting on berries, silver sagebrush, and wolf willow bushes. 50 other species of birds nest in the vegetative cover of the dunes. The rolling topography made this an ideal wintering ground for feral horses seeking cover from cold winter storms. In the summer, the horses used the hilltops to escape insects and as lookout posts for approaching danger. The changing face of the sandhills was proof of their presence.
This is the start of a budding sand dune, or a sand blowout. This area is bare in here. The grass has been removed, all vegetative cover has been removed, and as it goes up here with the wind, it tends to cut the grass off of this area, and the dune size expands. It's going further northeast all the time. This is a classic example of the root system of sand reed grass. As you can see, there's a proliferation of roots that tend to tie the sand together. There's no other plant that grows in the sandy area that has the withholding ability of the sand reed grass, because that's why the good Lord put it here, because it holds sand together better than any other species. When the sand reed grass is removed, such as it's been down here, there's no root system left here to hold the sand together. A root that's completely denuded.
Once you remove that vegetative cover, you get a lot of active sand movement. Now you want a little bit of that movement, but you don't want the huge extensive eroding areas which are totally devoid of life.
The impact of the horses was undeniable. 8 of the 11 dune areas in the Middle Sand Hills showed critically reduced vegetative cover. The Suffield horse had become a threat to its own home. Every year, thousands of acres of native grassland is lost to grain production or seeded pastures. The resulting fields of monocrops are of little value to the fauna that inhabit a prairie ecosystem. With each passing year, the value of our planet's natural diversity becomes more and more apparent. When a landscape is altered, our natural heritage disappears, taking with it a unique and mysterious system of wildlife that took millennia to evolve. Recognizing the few examples of undisturbed natural habitat that remain is the first step to maintaining them.
Canada is a signatory to a number of agreements, including the International Biodiversity Convention. And we have made a commitment to the world to look after our corners of the world. And that means everything from the smallest organisms to the largest.
Pitting a native ecosystem against a herd of beautiful animals was a no-win situation.
They would have been great until these fences come in. We wouldn't have had all this problems with the environment and that. And they could graze at different times of the year in different places. But once you get human beings and fences and that in here, you get these horses and that, they can't do what they're supposed to be doing. So it's up to us now to make decisions and to look after. They can't look after themselves basically like they would normally do.
Obviously is a bit of an emotional issue. I mean, it's very difficult in this province to find anybody who's against horses.
The military, which had the final word on the fate of the horses, sought advice from the Canadian Wildlife Service. Their message was unsentimental and explicit.
If we had feral cats or dogs in a national park, the public wouldn't stand for allowing these animals at large in a national park. And it's no different in terms of a national wildlife area. We had a population that was basically growing at a rate of 15 to 20% per year, and are reaching way beyond the carrying capacity of the landscape, and therefore they were having a major impact, and something had to be done.
Based on these recommendations, the military proposed a complete roundup of the horses, ending their free reign on the grasslands forever. But some strong objections were raised from beyond the borders of the base. Dr. Hugh Vance of Alberta's SPCA believed the decision was made in haste.
They showed us their information on why they thought the culls should be done, and we weren't convinced that it really needed to be done. So our organization, along with others, wrote to the Minister of Defense at that time and asked that the roundup be postponed for at least a year until some research could be done to establish whether a cull was needed, how many needed to be culled, and what the conditions would need to be established to maintain the rest of the herd.
A 12-member Citizens Advisory Committee was formed to assess the situation. The participants represented groups concerned with the fate of both the horses and the grassland. Their decision was difficult and came down to three choices: remove the horses, leave them alone, or manage them.
If you keep horses there, you have to manage the herd so that it doesn't get out of hand again. And that's where the rub came. We would have to use immunocontraception or an annual roundup and culling. And if we start managing the herd intensively, it's not a herd of wild horses anymore, is it?
The committee met seven times. With each meeting, it became clearer that the survival of the mixed grass prairie was a priority.
So that took precedence, in my decision at least, that the habitat was so precious. There were other options for the horses, but we couldn't sustain any more damage to the habitat.
After 5 months, the decision no one wanted to make was finalized. The horses would have to go. Not everyone agreed. Spokesperson for a coalition of animal rights groups, Claire Fluitt.
When they heard that we were going to be trying to stop them legally from doing this, of course, that all, you know, set the gears in motion, as it were, and they decided to go ahead with a winter roundup. We found out about this, you know, right at the very, very last minute. We had been in contact with the Department of National Defense on a daily basis trying to get more information about when they were going to run this. And we, in fact, found out from people that we knew that lived on the perimeter of the base that it had started already.
The decision to round up the horses triggered the next problem. Where would they go once they were removed from the land? The possibilities ranged from the bizarre, the horses being adopted by school children, to the traditional, slaughtering them for dog food.
So when we give it away, you and me and Monty and Kevin and Reg are gonna go south and swoop around. You guys just lay them over top of the hill, okay? And Kevin will make the swoop.
Myron Kulik, a local rancher, was hired by the military to conduct the roundup.
Well, just go out there and just see where they're at. You know, try to find where they're at. You're going to find them down in the draws or whatever, and then just get around them with these skidoos and bring them up in the air and just put them in bunches. They're scattered out in bunches at 5, 10, 15 or whatever, and you just put them bunches together and just take a small bunch in. And they go fairly hard for the first half, three quarters of a mile, and after that, you just get on a trot or a walk and you just bring them right in. I mean, they ain't that hard to handle it. As long as you're in the right place, get in the wrong place, you're going to be hard to handle them.
Feral horses are so well conditioned from years on the open plain that they can run much faster than the average domestic horse.
And these skidoos don't hurt them. I mean, you just get around them and take it easy with them, and just sometimes they figure like, I mean, they figure we got skidoos out here, we're gonna be chasing the hell out of things. And sometimes we're a quarter mile, half mile away from them, just bringing them around, you know. Because you get them running hard, they're gonna split in eight different directions, you're gonna lose them anyhow. You gotta keep them together. As long as they think they're getting away from you, they'll be just kind of hazing them around back and forth. I mean, a guy don't want to hurt them horse when we take these. Like we said, we're all stockmen. We don't want to hurt nothing. You know what I mean? Just take things as easy as we can.
It was quite a thrill to see them out there on the range. And the horses symbolize, to me at least, and I think to many people, freedom and independence and maybe even defiance, because they've sort of slipped the bounds of domestication. And they're out there in the wild, going where they want to roam and doing what they want to do and surviving. That's the romantic image of them anyway.
Colonel Keith Eddy, base commander.
The decision to round up the horses wasn't difficult in the sense that the evidence was there that something had to be done. It was difficult, as you suggest, in the sense that there is that romantic image of horses. From that point of view, it was difficult.
When horses sense danger, the harem will run as a unit, with the lead stallion pushing from behind, acting as a buffer between his family and the predator. Their survival strategy includes herding their harem towards other families of horses. They merge together, each harem hoping to reduce their own chance of injury or death. This instinctive behavior worked well for the stockmen. The apparent threat of a snowmobile was enough to drive the animals together and make the roundup much easier.
Now, that time of the year is it's physically the worst time for the horses. The mares are heavily in foal at that point. Physically, they're sort of down to their last resources. It was a hard winter. There was a lot of snow. They were pushing them through heavy snow. And I think it was very traumatic for the horses. And I think one of the reasons why they didn't put up as much fuss as they did is because they were too tired.
The herd that was taken off yesterday was pushed for 3 days. It was pushed for 10 miles, dropped off, left overnight. Pushed for another 10 miles, dropped off, left overnight. Finally, it was pushed to within 2 miles of the corrals, dropped off, left overnight. And then they went in the next day, pushed them for the 2 miles into the catch pen.
The military estimated there was about 850 horses wandering the base. The final tally was 1,201.
There are two sides to my story personally. I am a biologist, and my interest is the ecosystem first. But there's a lot of nostalgia in my own heart for the wild horses. I certainly went out and took pictures of them. I took my daughter out to view them. They were magnificent animals in many cases. And I feel a real loss. This was not an enjoyable event for me, but I think it's important that we do protect that ecosystem and find ways at the same time to preserve that important part of our heritage.
You know, when you drive by it now, you can see there ain't nothing left in it, eh? But I mean, it wouldn't be bad to keep a few down there. It wouldn't bother me a bit either, you know. But if they're buggering up the environment, I guess they got to leave, eh?
It'd be nice to see some, because there's not too many places where they got wild horses anymore. It's kind of nice to see you got wild horses.
In 3 short weeks, the last large herd of free-roaming horses on the Canadian prairie became part of history. And the National Wildlife Area was quiet once more, free of the weight of horses' hooves for the first time in decades. By the time the horses were gathered in the military catch pen, they had gained near celebrity status. For the first time, the mythical horses of Suffield were available for all to see. Aware of intense public scrutiny, the military proposed an adoption program, the first of its kind in Canada.
What we're doing here in this pen here, we've got mares. The next pen, we've got colts. The far pen down there, we've got studs, young studs. And in this pen, we've got mares.
When we decided to proceed with the Adopt a Horse program, we had 650 applicants. They were requesting over 25,000 horses. In other words, a lot of people wanted more than one horse. We thought that it was going to be much fairer if initially we limited people on the number of horses that they could adopt. First of all, that eliminates the entrepreneur that would just adopt 20 horses and run them to the slaughterhouse. We were after people that were genuinely interested in looking after these horses, providing them good homes.
Applicants came from as far as Ontario to take home a Suffield original. Each horse was adopted for a fee of $347.50. After covering the roundup costs, the military recorded a $90,000 profit, which was set aside for further environmental studies on the base.
She's facing this way. It's right up coming on the gate there.
That one?
Yeah.
They'll learn not to give a horse thief permission to come down here. Joe, they know how to pick good horses.
Well, I raised buffalo and elk and deer, and I just thought that I'd like to have some wild horses to keep.
One by one, the Suffield horses were loaded up and carted off, destined to begin completely new lives.
And they're going to a better home, because you get back out there, take a look at it right now. I mean, it ain't that nice out there, eh? This way your guy's going to have them at home, and they can feed them some oats and look out, and they're going to figure they're in heaven from coming out of the hills, eh?
No. Don't get around me. You're going nowhere. Stand. That's a good boy. That's a good boy.
Pam Sutherland acquired a Suffield horse for her daughter.
Because it's a wild horse and it's been rounded up, it hasn't had much dealings with humans. So it's going to learn that a human being is not something that's going to hurt it.
Easy, 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 no, easy, easy, no, no, easy.
Who's in command now, eh? Who's in there now, eh?
Whoa, buddy,
whoa.
Dan. Dan. Whoa. Whoa, Dan.
A lot of horses are scared of anything that rattles and flutters, and all it is to show the horse that no matter what I have or what I do with him, I'm not going to hurt him.
Trust. A bond of trust is developing between the horse and humans.
Oh, buddy. Oh. Oh, buddy. Oh. Oh, buddy. Oh. Oh, buddy. Oh. Ah, that. Oh, man. Oh, fella. Oh. Oh, buddy. Oh, son. Good, bud. Give her your best shot. Hey, never mind the hay. Come on, get over here.
The horses are back and we're not really send a search party.
Whoa, crap. Whoa. Whoa, baby. Whoa. Whoa, crap. Whoa. 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 Whoa, sweetie. Whoa, sweetheart. Whoa, crappie. Whoa, sweetie. Whoa, crappie. Whoa. Whoa, baby. Oh, Dad's girl, oh, baby.
Doug Johnson broke more than 300 of the feral horses pulled from the Suffield block.
Oh, sweetie. Oh, mama. Ah, that's a girl. Okay.
This mare's from Suffield Wild Horses. She's a 12-year-old. She's
got to be pretty tough mare to survive what she's gone through. And you see her ears have been froze off, so she had them froze as a baby, so she made it through that. This is what makes her kind of tough. She's kind of got a mind of her own, and she's survived it out here for 12 years, so she's just coming in her prime, really. That colt's 2.5 months old. The colt's going to be just like her mother. She's kind of got the same attitude already as her mother, and she's long and tall. And she's still got a good head on her, good legs. Probably in 3 years' time, you put the two together, and other than the cropped ears, they'd probably look like twins.
Although we no longer rely on the horse's strength or speed for survival, the horse is one of the few species that can consistently return affection and display loyalty. Of all the species, the horse is one of the most adept at slipping between wild and domestic states.
The very first time we saw the wild horses, Laura went in the corral with 6 wild horses loose. And I sort of sat there and I thought, I don't like this, I'm not happy. But the cowboy that was working with them said, as long as she's calm and quiet, she'll be fine. And within about a half an hour, she was stroking one of the wild horses, and I was amazed, absolutely amazed. I don't think there's a mean bone in their bodies. And they are very, very willing to work with you. I think it's a bit for them like going to Club Med. Everything's there after the hard life they've had in the past. And I think they appreciate it, and they know it's good, and they work for you, and they're really, really intelligent.
Much better. We're getting somewhere.
Whenever I tell people that she's a Suffield horse, a lot of times they go, really? I never would have guessed. So, I mean, she's just like any domestic horse, but she's really smart. But once she got used to people, it was just like any other horse.
While the horses settled into their new lives, their former home was going through its own transformation.
Well, one of the first things that we noticed was that there was a dramatic increase in cover. And along with that, there came more insects. And now for the first time in a couple of years, we're seeing leopard frogs in this pond. In fact, right here, as you look, you can probably see 30 frogs just sitting right in this area here.
The northern leopard frog is on Alberta's list of most endangered species. The single greatest threat to this animal is a changing habitat.
It surprised a lot of people at how quickly they were able to come back in this area. Partially due, I would imagine, because we had such a wet spring, but also because that this area is no longer being impacted by the horses. It's expected that this improvement is going to continue. As the frogs come back, other animals are also going to move into the area. We've seen rattlesnakes back in this area. We've seen blue herons in here. A lot of waterfowl is coming back. There's all sorts of deer beds down below here in the brush. None of this was evident in this area last year. So we've seen a dramatic improvement already just in this short time frame.
We visited some of those springs areas that were mud holes. The incredible amount of vegetation that is thriving there again. It still has a little bit more to go, but it shows that we didn't take it down to the lowest point where it couldn't recover.
Native habitats have become museum pieces, eco-samples that we study obsessively and manage questionably. It is only now, when ecosystems have all but disappeared, we desperately try to backpedal our way to ecological diversity.
Did we do the right thing? I think only time will tell. But in the short term, I believe we did the right thing.
This is the difficult story of compromise. For the moment, it seems the land is responding well to its horse-free status. But our involvement has had its risks, Major changes in habitat may be traced back to our irreversible intervention. By managing the land, we have entered into a contract with nature, and our competence is still in question.